warm welcome to Dr. Nancy O'Hara. She is a pediatrician for the Center for Integrative Health. We're really grateful Dr. O'Hara has presented. This is the second time she's been a part of our events. She actually came to Massachusetts last April and spoke in front of a group of parents, but even more importantly, she spoke in front of a group of doctors. It was a private breakfast so that we could raise awareness and help doctors, pediatricians, neurologists learn more about this, and Dr. Harrow was there, so we are very grateful for her volunteering to help us out. Today, Dr. Harrow is going to present on transforming a devastating chronic illness into a treatable disorder. So if you could all just give her a warm welcome.
Thanks, Kim. I always get this after lunchtime, and I think it's because I have a reputation for keeping people awake at least most of the time. So if you fall asleep, I don't mind, but I'll point you out. My mentor, that's mine, actually. This is the third person. Oh, you want me to put it down? Okay. My mentor always said to me, you know, tell them how you got here. And I have been working in an integrative practice, taking care of children with autism for the last 16 years, and working with Vicki Koblener, who's a dietitian here today, and others. And about 6 years ago, my son developed seizure-like tics overnight. And it was a week after he received from his mother the single-dose measles vaccine. Received a strep infection from his best friend and got a Lyme positive tick all in the same week. And thankfully, because of what I was doing, I was able to throw the kitchen sink and a few other things at him. And within 3 months, he was back to himself. But that started me on this road, and I am very grateful to him and to others in helping me down this path. You have the handouts in your little folders. So there are about 72 slides in there, and I am not going to do all 72, especially the pieces about Lyme, because we're really not talking about that today, but I wanted you to have the information. So it should be pretty clear. And I'm also going to, you know, what we're talking about is the assessment and treatment of all of these types of encephalopathies. Autoimmune encephalitis, the way the immune and metabolic systems get disrupted to affect the brain. And we keep changing the names because we keep broadening the diagnosis. Sue said most recently when we were speaking together in Orlando that it's now going to be post-streptococcal or post-infectious autoimmune encephalitis of the basal ganglia. So much easier than pandas, but anyway. And those of you who are groupies and come to a lot of these talks, we'll have seen this slide many times, but I think it's really important. Follow those who seek the truth, but flee from those who have found it. None of us have all the answers. And it's about those of us who are willing to look for the answers and keep looking and keep trying to figure out what's going on with our kids. All of these illnesses are not genetic illnesses. They are not easy illnesses. They are illnesses that we need to look at all of the possibilities that are going on. So I think you guys know this. Dr. Trifoletti started talking about this, so I'm going to go through this very fast. You know, the whole idea of molecular mimicry, friendly fire, the idea that the immune system has gone awry, and that rather than just attacking the germ, it's also attacking the brain. And that's what's leading to the autoimmune disease. We've got lots of examples of it. Hashimoto's thyroiditis presented back in 1912 with mental symptoms with a physical illness. We see this all the time, lupus, diabetes, myasthenia gravis, Sydenham's chorea, pandas and pitans are all autoimmune diseases. So let's look at the criteria. You know, when you talk strictly about pandas or PANS, it's an acute onset. I certainly agree with Dr. Trifoletti that there are a lot of our kids that have a much more chronic picture. And when you're talking about the strictest of diagnoses, it's an acute onset of OCD or tics. We absolutely have older children, adolescents, adults, but it is a pediatric onset by definition and an episodic course. What's really important is that these kids are having lots of other neurologic, emotional, somatic complaints, and we'll go over several of those in detail. And one of the things they have is choreiform movements, and it's something that can almost be pathognomonic in many of these children. If the kids stand with their hands out in front of them and shut their eyes, their fingers will start moving like they're playing the piano. And I had a little girl come and see me who is doing very well, is on treatment and was doing great, and she came to see me just 2 weeks ago. And the exam was negative, we agreed that she was doing wonderfully, and then the mom sent me a video yesterday, she's in a flare, and all of a sudden that movement I told her to look for is going on again. So it's not temper tantrums, it's not her emotional lability because she's a brat. About where these kids have had strep infections. Often they'll have strep infections in their throat, but many will not. The rapid test is often negative, and many of these kids, it's very hard to get an accurate culture of their throats, or they have an ear infection or a sinus infection at the same time and are never actually diagnosed with strep, even though they have it. The tonsils and the adenoids are other areas where they may have bacteria. I have often had a child have a TNA, a tonsil and adenoidectomy, and the ENT, when we culture it, will say, oh my gosh, these adenoids are horrific, and the strep that was never cultured on the throat is inside the adenoids. We also, Dr. Trifoliotti said, we'll often see kids with sinus infections and recurrent, chronic, or recalcitrant sinus infections. And then also looking at these other areas. And the GI tract, I think, is another area that is often overlooked. And Emerson didn't mean the gut when he said this, but the gut is of paramount importance in all of our kids. And I think it's something that is overlooked when we talk about kids, especially kids with multiple infections, strep and Lyme and yeast and viruses. We have to look and be aware of what's going on in the gut. So why is there such controversy? Well, as I said, most pediatricians, 79%, will treat presumed strep infection without a culture. So you never have a documented strep infection. The use of antibiotics for multiple ear infections in the past will make antibiotics, even if you use it at the acute onset of PANDAS, will make that antibiotic, like penicillin or amoxicillin, not work because you've already seen it so many times. That strep is resistant to that particular antibiotic. They say there's a small number of prospective studies, but there are actually a tremendous number of studies, which we'll go over. And then the relatedness to the OCD and ticks. So this was a compilation of studies that was done. Tanya Murphy looked at this many years ago. And basically the idea with each of these categories is to say, there is an association with group A strep in 9 of the 13 studies that were done. There's improvement with immune therapy in 6 of the 9 studies, et cetera, et cetera. So there are many more positive studies showing that there is definitely a correlation, in this case just with strep, to the autoimmune encephalitis, and then also all the other bacteria and other germs that we see. This is a study that Dr. Mel did looking at the association controlled between the onset of ticks or OCD and strep infections. And it showed that there were a greater correlation of multiple strep infections or of one strep infection before the onset of OCD or ticks in the kids with that as opposed to the kids, the controls. Okay, so let's look at the diagnosis. As Judy presented so wonderfully earlier this morning, the neuropsychological testing is very important, and there are multiple neurocognitive effects that we see on our kids' executive functioning and their ability to go to school, to learn, to attend, to listen, to see the way other kids are seeing. And I think that neuropsych testing is very important for all of our kids. But there are also other clues. There are physical exam clues that we use, not just that choreiform movement, but there are other exam clues. Some kids will have peeling fingers. So, you know, like when you peel glue off your fingers, which I love to do, that peel of skin back after a strep infection is pathognomonic for strep. It's rare, we don't see it that much, but if you see that, you've definitely had a strep infection. You also may see a red anal ring, not the diffuse redness on the buttocks we often see like with yeast or eczematous diaper rashes, but especially in a child not in diapers, that red ring around their anus. That's strep, and strep in the gut. We also have lots of other infectious etiologies that we look at with the autoimmune encephalitis. And kids with warts or molluscum may well have a viral antecedent. Kids with ringworm, tinea capitis, may well have a yeast antecedent. Peeling wet rash on the feet, a geographic tongue, a strawberry tongue may well be strep. A thrush-like tongue, a white, placky tongue, may well be yeast. And I think, you know, when you go to a doctor and they say, well, that kid doesn't have thrush, it may not be thrush, but a white tongue is somewhere in that spectrum of there may well be yeast in the gut. A geographic tongue may well be other germs in the tongue. A strawberry tongue, and you know what I mean by the strawberry tongue, it's sort of like where the little papilla, where the little taste buds are sticking up so it looks like a strawberry. You know, all of these are signs that may be helpful in figuring out what's going on with a child. This is just the wet peel that we see with athlete's foot. That's a kid that has yeast. These are the ridged yellow nails. You know, the big nail is like grandpa nails. You've seen those Lamisil commercials where you have the thick, yellow, gross nails. But what I want you to look at is also the littler nails. They're also slightly discolored, also slightly ridged. And little kids may not have grandpa nails by the time they're 3 or 7 or whatever, but they may have some early indications. So I think, you know, one of the colleagues that I work with once asked, well, we need to know all the biomarkers for these kids, all the lab tests that we need to do. This isn't about lab tests. This is about the history and physical exam that helps us to decide what germ or germs may be a trigger for these kids. But let's talk about testing because we've got to talk about it. There may be an elevation in strep titers. If it's at the onset of the illness, those strep titers may well be negative. So if you get it just as the symptoms are presenting, you may have totally normal tests, but later that ASO or anti-DNase B, which you can get at the regular lab, may well be elevated 4 to 6 weeks later. There may be other autoimmune conditions. Another one that you may measure is an ANA. 56% of kids with PANDAS will have a positive ANA. ANA is a test we do for lupus, but this will be positive in sort of that diffuse pattern. We also will see other abnormalities on the lab test that you may not get from your regular lab, but we know from research testing that there are multiple abnormalities, as Dr. Trifoletti was starting to say this morning, in interferon, in natural killer cells, in our T cells, and our viral processing. We are learning more and more about the genetics and the molecular underpinnings that set up these kids to get serious illnesses, autoimmune illnesses, after an infection. So Dr. Trifoletti talked a little bit about that this morning. I'm not going to go into any more detail right now. But what we see is that these kids get inflammation of their brain. It is diffuse, but one of the areas that is affected is the basal ganglia. And these antibodies activate the proteins in the brain, and these proteins increase the release of dopamine that inhibits the T cells, that causes an autoimmune inflammation of the brain and of the basal ganglia, that causes more activation of the immune system, and then you see the behaviors. So we can see this over and over again in the brains of our kids. One of the tests, one of the booths that out here is Moleculera, and that's the CAM kinase testing. If you have a child that has been very hard to diagnose, you don't know if this is going on, if there's autoimmune encephalitis, your child's in the midst of a flare and nobody's believing you, I think going forward, this will be a test that is very helpful, both to insurance companies as well as to physicians in general. If the child has been sick for a very long time and is not in the middle of the flare, the antibodies may be less positive or may in fact be negative, but it can be very helpful in the diagnosis. Other inflammatory markers, I mentioned the ANA, but sedrate and CRP are also very helpful. And looking at other germs, which we're going to talk about in a minute, and you've heard about, you know, certainly Lyme, mycoplasma, and other infections. And this is, you know, pictures worth a thousand words. This is from one of Madeline Cunningham's papers, looking at first the SC is Sydenham's chorea, so very elevated levels of CAM kinase. The kids with pandas have also very elevated levels, and then the kids without pandas much lower. So it's a very different grouping. Down at the bottom, you'll see the kids with pandas, and then the other kids are kids with either OCD or tics or ADHD or neurotypical kids that have otherwise, you know, fairly normal levels. So that particular test can be very helpful. It's not cheap. So, you know, let's just put that out there. But it can be very helpful if you don't know if this is going on for your child. They're looking at other brain antibodies also that are very important. Dopamine 1, dopamine 2, lysoganglioside, tubulin, as well as the CAM kinase. And this is just another graphic interpretation of it. You know, the Sydenham's chorea and the pandas kids, much different than the controls. Okay, and Dr. Trifoletti said a little bit about this. You know, we can induce these symptoms in our animal models by giving them the group A strep antigen and exhibiting the symptoms that we see in our kids. So this is what I want to get to and spend more time on, so that's why I zipped through all that other stuff. Let's talk about treatment, because that's really what a lot of people need these days. First of all, I think all of our kids need to be on probiotics. And I'm not just talking about all of our kids, of those of you in the room, I mean all of our kids. I think that it's one of the things that we have really disturbed biomes. Our guts, our systems, living in the world that we're living in, are very disturbed. And probiotics is, in some cases, a drop in the bucket. It's not much. And believe me, if you're getting your probiotics from Activa or anything like that, it's even more, excuse the expression, even though it's on tape, pissing in the wind. You know, you've got to do high-dose probiotics while you're treating with antibiotics, especially for Lyme or strep. You have to increase those good germs at the same time, or you're going to get into repeated problems. I think xylitol is an excellent natural sweetener that also has some wonderful antimicrobial properties. It comes as a nasal spray, it comes in gum, it comes in toothpaste, it comes as a powder. Saccharomyces boulardii, if you haven't heard of it, is a natural yeast against yeast that helps to support the immune system, increase that part of the immune system within the gut that is very important, secretory IgA, and helps to decrease other germs. There are a small percentage of kids that are actually sensitive to it and will not do well with it, but it is something to consider. Also, when you're under stress, things are more acidic. When things are acidic, what happens? They get rusty. When things are rusty, they don't work as well. So you want your system, when your system is under stress, to be more alkalinized. So there are lots of ways to do that. And one of them is charcoal. And charcoal is a great, you know, it binds up the toxins or those things you want to get out of the system. If your child is having a bad reaction to something or have a flare, the first thing we recommend is, as Dr. Trifoletti said, ibuprofen. If ibuprofen helps that flare, helps that behavior, then you're on the right track with an inflammatory reaction. The other thing that can happen is your child is having a bad reaction to something they're taking. If that's happening, then you can give them charcoal and pull it out of their system, and that will help to decrease the symptoms also. So when anybody calls me and says they're in a flare, I tell them to do those two things. If one doesn't help, the other often does. And then antibiotics. We try to do this herbally. We try to do this naturally. We try to do this homeopathically. But many of our kids do need antibiotics. One is IM bicillin. For our kids that have multiple gut problems, that can be very helpful in avoiding the gut. It's an intramuscular injection. Problem is, it's very painful. It's a thick white liquid that is very painful. But if it helps, there are many of our kids that will come back again and again, both against their wishes. I'm looking for some of my kids that have been in here. By their own admission. Other antibiotics we use are all listed here. What's very interesting about some of these antibiotics, clavulanate, which is part of Augmentin, as well as azithromycin, which is what your Z-Pak is, have anti-inflammatory properties also. So it may not be just the antibiotic properties, but it's the anti-inflammatory properties that are very important. What's also important is antibiotic prophylaxis, because we do know in this episodic course of things that children will, have second and third and fourth flares, and every flare can be worse. And this goes to some of the phases that Dr. T was talking about earlier. We do recommend getting an EKG with azithromycin, not because we're really worried about it, but there has been reports in adults and a research study showing prolongation of an interval of your rhythm, a QT interval. So you want to make sure that a child doesn't have that before you put them on azithromycin. These are some of the herbs that we will try using, and we do have kids in our practice that are just on herbs prophylactically. And knock on wood, so far so good. And then immune modulators. And I think this is one of the things that is often forgotten, is that this is an immune and metabolic disease. It's not just an infectious disease, and that goes for strep and Lyme and all of these germs. It's the immune and metabolic reaction to the infectious trigger. So if you're not dealing with and treating those things, you're not going to be treating the whole child. There have been studies of oral immunoglobulins, which I'm not going to get into because the follow-up studies have not been positive. Minocycline, which is an antibiotic that also has excellent anti-inflammatory properties, can be very helpful in our kids with Lyme, as well as some of our kids with PANDAS. Certainly IVIG, there have been several studies. Perlmutter studies was one of the best, showing a marked decrease in OCD. After one IVIG. Plasmapheresis, as Dr. T mentioned. And then there's a booth outside from a group called Biome Restoration. And when I was talking about our biomes and our guts being disturbed, one of the things that some people are using are worm eggs to try to reset that appropriate inflammatory reaction. And we can get into that more later in the question and answer or talk to Judy outside, because I think that's a very interesting form of therapy that can be very helpful to many of our kids. Okay, antibiotics. There's a 35% failure rate to eradicate strep with penicillin. We don't usually use amoxicillin, penicillin for the first line when the kids see us, because most of those kids have already been on multiple courses of amoxicillin or penicillin. We will sometimes use ceftonir, which is Omnicef. Sometimes Augmentin, as I said, it has good anti-inflammatory properties also, although many of these children also have yeast overgrowth, and that can certainly exacerbate that. And then azithromycin, also because there can be tremendous help if the child also has mycoplasma. If the child also has Lyme, azithromycin is a good antibiotic to consider. And then sometimes clindamycin in those kids that have multiply resistant treatment courses. What else do we use in our treatment? Sometimes we'll use steroids, especially if a child, we know this is an autoimmune condition that's going on and they haven't improved with antibiotics. We will then use a short burst of steroids diagnostically as well as therapeutically. It's a temporary fix. It's not something to do long term, but it can be helpful. And it proves that there's an inflammatory reaction and may help us to pursue further treatment. Some of our kids will get worse with steroids, though. So again, you have to be very careful. Plasmapheresis, as we've talked about, can be very helpful in the rapid cessation of symptoms, especially in our kids that present with very severe symptoms. And then IVIG, which I think Dr. Bouboulis will talk more about next, but certainly can be helpful in many of our children in controlling the inflammatory reaction. One thing to keep in mind when you're talking about the strictest criteria of PANDAS, it's one and done. It's one round of IVIG, and that's all that child should need to improve. Unfortunately, in many of our children who have chronic immunodeficiency, who have multiple germs, who have other chronic inflammations, who are in later phases of their disease, one and done does not always work. And so we have to look at either multiple rounds or we have to look at other ways of treating their immune system. And we'll talk about that a little bit more. So in our practice, if we have a kid that comes in, we'll use an initial course of antibiotics up to 30 days. If it's Lyme disease, that changes to up to 3 months. We'll use steroids in recalcitrant cases, in severe cases, IVIG or plasmapheresis. And we will, at times, use medications to decrease the symptoms, because some of these kids are in such a horrible state, we really need to decrease the symptoms very quickly. And in treating, we can get a flare, a Herx reaction, a die-off, whatever you want to call it, they can get worse. And that really stinks. And so sometimes in the very acute settings, we need to do something else to decrease the symptoms. I think one of the therapeutic options that definitely has to be considered in these kids is cognitive behavioral therapy, social cognition therapy. That can be very helpful to these kids, and glad to we can all talk about that later. And then, as I said, antibiotic prophylaxis. Many of these children need to be on antibiotics at least till they're through puberty, some till they're adults, and we have now a few kids that are now in their 20s that need to continue on prevention. And I'll show you one of those little boys at the end of the talk. Okay. But it really is, just as autism is, it's a puzzle, and it's putting all the pieces of the puzzle together. And that means looking at all of the different infections that may be part of it. And it's also looking at stress, because stress is a huge trigger. And stress has an immunologic trigger as well as just a psychologic and neurologic trigger. And so, you know, when we hear people say, well, it's just stress, that's why they're getting worse. Well, yeah, it's stress, but it's the immune trigger that provides. So we look at viruses, Coxsackie, parvo, EBV, CMV. Titers are not always helpful. Sometimes they are, but they're not always helpful. And there are many more viruses than we can even test for. In these children, sometimes there are N of one, meaning we have to look at the individual child. And if the historical or physical exam pieces look like this child has a viral antecedent, we'll try therapy, like vitamin A, like olive leaf extract, like lysine, which is an amino acid, like natural antivirals, and then antiviral medications like amantadine and valacyclovir. We look at sinusitis, both bacterial and yeast sinusitis. We look at mycoplasma. The IgM and IgG titers that Dr. T mentioned, but also IFA, which is an immunofluorescent assay, which can help differentiate if a child has an acute case of mycoplasma or if it's a previous case of mycoplasma. And then Lyme. And again, just like everything else, Lyme is a clinical diagnosis. However, you can use testing that can be helpful. Not really LabCorp or Quest, in my opinion. They're very minimal bands within the Western blot. Clinical Lab Partners does a little bit better job in that they have an extended Western blot. And then certainly Igenex has become more of the gold standard. And then there's also the ability through Advanced Lab, Dr. Bransfield talked about this last week at a Lyme conference, for culturing, if your child has not been on antibiotics in the last 3 months, for actually culturing the spirochete. And that can help with the diagnosis. But all of these, Lyme included, are multi-system disorders. There's the infection, there's the immune dysfunction, there's the toxic piece, the allergic piece, the nutritional deficiencies, The mitochondrial deficiencies, you saw those complexes that Dr. T put up. That mitochondria is the energy cells of all of our body. They're the little microorganisms with the micromolecules within each of our cells that help our engines to run. And if your body has been hit with a toxin, anesthesia, a vaccine, a chemical or metal toxin, a virus or germ, that mitochondria takes a hit. And you will have secondary mitochondrial dysfunction. And so you have to deal with that also. This is the part where you get really overwhelmed and you're like, oh my God. It gets better. It's get better. There's endocrine and metabolic issues. There's GI issues. And certainly, as I said, there's the stress issues. So this is the part where I'm going to, how am I doing? What do we got? 20? 17? Okay. So this is the part that has all the information on Lyme, and I'm not going to go through all the details. I will say a few things, though. First of all, with regard to that, the short-term failure rate is very, very high, because in the most cases, we don't use antibiotics long enough. And we need to use them until we're symptom-free. We also, when we're on antibiotics, whether for pandas or for Lyme, make the it's a problem not to to protect the child against yeast and other germs and not to protect the liver. So those things have to be done. And then we also have to look about how we detoxify. I talked about ibuprofen and charcoal. Epsom salts baths are another good way to detoxify. If your child always seems to flare after they go swimming in a chlorinated pool, the chlorine can be a trigger. If they always get sick when they go into a certain environment in their school, that the chemicals or dust mites or molds may be a trigger. One of the things that you can do is use Epsom salts. We often will use it in a bath, but many of our kids are now not taking baths, or if they're out the pool, you can put the Epsom salts about a quarter a cup in a big spray bottle and spray them down with that, and that can be very helpful. Or magnesium salts. Those can be very helpful. And then immunotherapy. We talked about the big guns of like IVIG, but there are lots of other less invasive immunotherapy that we need to think about. Diet is very important. And it's not, you know, I'm not going to stand up here and say everybody should be casein-free and gluten-free, because I'm not going to say that, but, you know, there are a lot of inflammatory foods that we eat, and certainly sugars, a lot of carbs for our kids are very inflammatory foods, and we need to have an anti-inflammatory diet. We can talk more about that in the Q&A if you want to, but one of the things is adequate protein. What do we have for breakfast? Not that this wasn't a wonderful spread, but what did we have here? We had muffins. We had carbs. That's what we eat for breakfast in America. That's a stinky breakfast. We need to give our kids protein. They need to have frequent meals and snacks, but they need to be protein-rich snacks and meals, especially early in the day. Then we need to think about probiotics, prebiotics, which are the things like the Saccharomyces. We need to think about other immune therapy, aloe, curcumin, which is the active ingredient in this spice turmeric. Several spices are really good anti-inflammatories, garlic, ginger, turmeric, and many others. We need to look at things like quercetin, resveratrol, which is what's in red wine. Don't want all of your kids to go home and drink red wine, but for the parents that are dealing with the stress of all of this. And herbals, you know, olive leaf extract, elderberry, astragalus, these are all very important adjuncts to what we're doing when we talk about the big guns. So this is the part I'm going to skip over with the Lyme treatment, but it's all there for all your herbals, all your co-infections, which are all very, very important. But I put them there because I think many of our kids are dealing with, as I said, multiple infections and a multi-system problem. So our treatment pitfalls, we don't address the immunotherapy. We treat strep or pandas with an antibiotic and we say you're done. Not even our kids that recover very quickly are done. We need to address immunotherapy. Not addressing yeast is part of that. Not addressing underlying mitochondrial and metabolic, and I'm going to talk about that next a little bit. And then certainly we have to deal with medication side effects. So, and this is the white paper. Dr. T talked about this a little bit. In January of 2012, you know, PANDAS was always very controversial, and Sue Sweeto and others got together and said, how can we bring this together so A, it's not as controversial, and we can bring all these other triggers together. And so you have the group that is PANDAS, the group that is PITANS, and on there is Lyme, mycoplasma, and we talked about several others, including viruses that are on there, and then all the environmental and metabolic disorders. And that's something that we've been talking about for many years. And so it's all of those things that go into the acute onset of neuropsychiatric symptoms. So it's not to replace PANDAS, but it's to include all the other infectious etiologies, as well as the toxic exposures, the mitochondrial changes that we may see, the metabolic changes. And I think one of the biggest ones is reduced levels of glutathione, and we'll talk about that. And then vitamin and mineral deficiencies and changes in diet. So I know those of you who are groupies have seen this before, but who hasn't seen this kind of pathway? Okay. Not too. You guys are up. You guys are good. Anyway, this is the methylation, sulfation, folation part of all of our bodies. This is basically how all of our bodies detoxify. And it looks complicated, but think of it in this way. Methionine is an amino acid at the top. So that's what we eat. We eat food. And we have to break down food through all of these processes to get to glutathione. That's the GSH. Glutathione in its good form looks like this. It's got a sulfur molecule sticking off it, which is sticky. So think of glutathione as sticking to all those things you got to get out of your system. You got to get that cookie you just ate for lunch out of your system. You got to get the chemicals and the metals and the germs and the allergens out of your system. Glutathione is what's doing that all the time. Well, our kids in the autism world have a 71% decrease in that form of good glutathione. They instead have GSSG, which is where the two sticky parts are stuck together. Well, if your sticky parts are stuck together, they can't stick to anything else. So they have ineffective detoxification. We know that kids with ADHD, that's more like 60% decrease in that. It hasn't been studied yet in PANDAS, but I can tell you anecdotally from our population, it will come out, that these kids have that same decrease. So it's part of the reason genetically that they're predisposed to not be able to get rid of these things out of their bodies. So a lot of the things that we talk about in vitamins and minerals, folate, you know, the MTHFR defect, the casein and gluten, the antivirals, a lot may be making this pathway work better. And I think if we don't look at this and we're treating the germs and we're treating the immune system, but we don't also look at this, we're missing another big piece of the puzzle. So again, PANDAS, I think, Dr. Leventhal and Dr. Trifoletti both talked about all of these very well. I think one of the things to just reemphasize, besides the emotional and psychological and educational deficits, as well as the OCD and tics that we see, we have to look at the somatic symptoms. And a child that has those, in addition to new onset separation anxiety, new onset somatic complaints like sleep disturbances or urinary frequency or urgency, is an autoimmune encephalitis until proven otherwise. So throat cultures, negative cultures are not the gospel. We have to look beyond the throat. We have to check family members. And in that family is also your family dog. And look for other family members that may have recurrent or chronic strep that may be a problem. And that may be throat cultures, it may be blood tests, but you have to check the family members. Antibiotic prophylaxis may be needed to be continued throughout the year and until adulthood. The importance of immunotherapy, as I've said, I mentioned a couple others there, like oral colostrum. Colostrum in our milk-sensitive kids isn't good, but there is goat colostrum. The best form of goat colostrum is right from the goat. So if you don't have a goat farm, you know. Steroids, and again there, I mention Hellman therapy, and I think that's something, that's a book that I mentioned there, Epidemic of Absence, that we can talk about again in the question and answer period if we want to. And IVIG. And just to keep in mind, there's a big difference between the dosage of IVIG that we use for immunodeficiency, which is a much lower dose, and the dose that we may need to use for autoimmune encephalitis, which is a much higher dose. And oftentimes, if the child has both, you really have to look at what is going on for that individual child as to what dosage is necessary for him or her. So we look at, for PANS, we look at the strep, other infectious etiologies, other environmental and metabolic etiologies that lead to the acute onset of OCD, of tics, of aggression, of regression in behaviors or learning, of anorexia. We have several kids in our practice and young boys with new onset of anorexia. And yes, they have the body image distortion. Yes, they have some of the classic anorexic picture, but the anorexia is in fact part of their OCD. And it may be part of their mitochondrial deficiency also, because many of these children develop difficulty swallowing. So. We look at the specific individual and family history, and it's got to be a comprehensive intervention. So it's a clinical diagnosis again. You confirm it by strep titers. All of our kids that come into our practice need to get strep titers. They need to get Lyme testing. They need to get mycoplasma testing. They need to get viral testing. They need to get immune markers, CRP, sed rate, ANA, thyroid antibodies, immunoglobulins, strep pneumococcal serotypes. Can be very helpful. We also think all of these kids need to get urine organic acids. That's a very good test to look at metabolic pathways within the body. It also can look at metabolites of germs, other germs that we can't test well in the blood. Germs like Clostridia, parasites, yeast can be found on the metabolite, their metabolites in the urine organic acid testing. We also will measure a cysteine level. That pathway I showed you, you know, one of the easiest measures is a cysteine level. From the regular lab, you can get a homocysteine, which is also part of that pathway. Those two pieces can be very helpful. And all of this testing can be done to your regular lab. This is all regular lab testing. The only one that's not is cysteine, and it's $45. So we're not breaking the bank to get this testing. And then use the treatment as a diagnostic tool also. If I think a child has it, no matter what the tests show, we'll treat. And that treatment in our N of one, in our one child, is also diagnostic. If that child gets better with that initial treatment, well, then we have our diagnosis. So let's talk about our N of one. This is one of my other favorites, Robert Frost, Two Roads Diverged, and I Took the One Less Traveled By, and that has made all the difference. That it takes me back to 16 years ago when I was a card-carrying pediatrician and in a private practice, a partner in that practice, and it was moms of children on the spectrum who said to me, we need somebody to integrate all of our care. And that has made a tremendous difference in my life and in looking at things in this way. So let's look. I want to take a few minutes. Do I have five or? Okay, so I want to show you a couple kids because, again, just like a picture is worth a thousand words, each child is important. And this is one little boy who presented to us at age five with a new onset of tics. And it was very sudden onset of vocal tics. And he kept saying, excuse me, every 5 seconds. He repeated it at different tones, different pitches, different levels of exclamation. He even did it during sleep. He had, with any brief waking all night long, he would say it over and over and over again. He also had some motor tics, some itching and smelling of his buttocks, touching his shoulders in a particular sequence, and a change in his personality. He had been a very sweet and compliant little boy and now was incredibly anxious and problems with attention. And he began putting everything in his mouth and frequent urination. Okay, so what do you think? Oh, really? Okay. he had a normal pregnancy and birth. He was breastfed, but had poor latching initially. He was healthy, had very few infections, normal development. He had some sensory issues, some sensitivities. His mom had given him an alternative vaccination schedule and an organic diet. He had no known other exposures, surgeries, injuries, and there was a family history of arthritis, cancer, and diabetes. Why I give that is because I think that history is really important. A child that has problems initially latching on may be set up to have mitochondrial deficiencies and dysfunction later in life. A child with constipation, a child with low tone. I think it's also important that this was a child that, you know, for our world almost lived in a bubble. You know, an organic diet, an alternative vaccination schedule, and no infections and all of that. He hadn't been incited. There were no other triggers early in his life. But he was a setup. He had probably some amount of sensory processing disorder before this, and he had a family history that was full of autoimmune disease. So I think those are very important histories. He had had a sore throat at the end of March, strep culture negative. He had had his first MMR vaccine at age 5 at the end of April, and 1.5 weeks after that had developed violent vomiting and fever, and had a sibling with a positive strep culture in early May. And then he started his symptoms in early May. There were no Lyme tick exposures, no other infectious symptoms. So again, a few triggers all at once. So we have a new vaccine that's a live virus vaccine that he had never seen. We have a sibling that's sick, and he had a reaction. So we look at all of the different possibilities. He went to see a neurologist initially who thought that he was having seizures, did an EEG, and that was negative. And then he told him that he had Tourette's. Anyway, he went to his pediatrician, who is a wonderful guy, and automatically put him on azithromycin, which was great. And he had been on it for about a month when they came to see us with no change in the ticks. He had done blood work at that time, had negative strep tests, negative Lyme, normal CBC and sed rate. And so he came to our office about 6 weeks later. We immediately put him on probiotics and essential fatty acids. And I gave him IV glutathione at the time. He was an active, you know, obviously I was drawing his blood and I had a site to be able to do that. But again, just that little bit of history that there were several inciting factors at once. He hadn't gotten better with a good antibiotic. So we did that. And we did repeat blood work and all of those things. And the only test of all of the tests was that was abnormal was that very low cysteine. Again, that pathway. And he returned 2 weeks later, and the ticks had completely resolved after the IV glutathione. So I don't present this that it's not PANDAS. It is, but this child had a metabolic abnormality that needed to be treated also. And so we put him on several interventions going forward to provide more support for that metabolic pathway. Okay, and then I'm going to end with one other little boy. Daniel was an 8-year-old with PDD. He had been in our practice for quite some time, and he had a sudden change in behavior. Uncontrolled agitation, aggression, OCD behaviors, became very ritualistic, developed some verbal tics, hyperactivity, and at the time he had had recurrent sore throats, all of which were culture negative. Because of his behaviors, he became very out of control, became aggressive toward his brothers and then others in the community, and was hospitalized. By the time the mom called me, he had been tried on 8 different antipsychotic medications and had been in and out of the hospital 6 or 7 different times. And the same things we did with him. He received 1 IVIG, and his symptoms resolved. And this is Daniel. When I asked Daniel if I could show his picture in the talk, he said, well, you can only show the picture when I'm happy, after I got better. Unfortunately, for Daniel, I'll do that in a minute, they moved down to North Carolina, and he was doing great on antibiotic prophylaxis. For many, many years, and this slide is actually from when I first started giving lectures probably 12, 14 years ago. Daniel is now in his 20s, and he stopped taking prophylaxis, as, you know, he probably should have at age 21, and he got a mycoplasma infection and severely regressed. And at 21, as a very large male now, it was even scarier. They could not at the time find anybody in North Carolina to help them. We have since found a wonderful doctor down there that is helping them. But they drove very dangerously in the car up here. And we got Daniel started back on treatment. He did another IVIG and now has done six since that time and is coming back to who he is. So I bring him up both because of the initial presentation. This is a child with autism, but he also had PANDAS. And this is a child with PANDAS that over time got better with appropriate treatment, but then after appropriate treatment was stopped, had a recrudescence of his symptoms. So we need to be careful, but we also need to be vigilant. And we need to continue to look for the ways to treat these kids, and we need to treat them all as completely and as fully as we can. So I applaud you for being here. I think I hope that we can spread this message to many more practitioners, parents, school people, to try to help more and more of our kids. And now my brain is full.